and the most talented players who have ever graced this court. But the roof is not the only change this year. There is enhanced capacity. Another 1,200 seats have been put in place for people to enjoy the center court experience. And I'm sure all of you sitting here are appreciating the much wider and more comfortable seats that have also been put in place. I'll take that as a yes. Well, of course, this is a special occasion which we're looking forward to, but it's also a very serious one as well, because this is the first time that tennis is going to be played on the court with the roof closed in front of a full house. So it is going to be a big test just to see how the court fares under these new conditions. I'm just going to glance over now to the Wimbledon committee members just to see if they're a little bit worried. No, they're not, so we won't be either, because we are here to celebrate. It's going to be a fabulous afternoon, entertainment all the way. I'm going to start by introducing the four players to you, starting with a player who's a former Grand Slam champion. She's a former world number one, and around the world she was one of the most popular players on tour. Now, she is joined by a man who has thrilled, teased, and traumatized us here on center court. For more than a decade, he did British tennis proud. He even has a hill named after him just at the back here. Would you please welcome them onto the court, Kim Clijsters and Tim Henman. Welcome, guys. Okay, well, next, well, they are the most famous couple in sport. I could stand here and list their achievements, but I'd be here for a long time because they have won titles and Grand Slam titles galore. They're also a rare breed of players in the modern era who have won all four Grand Slams. So I'm just going to keep it simple. Here are two great champions, two of the nicest people. Will you welcome back to the court they made their own, Steffi Graf and Andre Agassi. Welcome back, my word, and what a welcome. This must be lovely for you two to share this together.
Very much. No, this is very special. I mean, you know, coming back from behind there and just seeing this visual, and that's an amazing moment.
Lovely welcome to you. Standing ovation.
Oh, it's amazing. I mean, tennis players compete their whole lives to earn the right to stand here, and for us to be here today on such a special occasion is something we'll get to live the rest of our lives with.
I'll come back and talk to you guys in a moment. I'm just going to talk to your opponents today. Are you ready for this, Tim?
Nearly. I think preparation hasn't quite been as intense as it could have been, but Kim said yesterday she's been practicing for 16 weeks, so I was pretty happy that she was on my side of the net.
Now tell us, Kim, because you agreed to do this, you've started practicing, and then tell us what happened, because it's sort of changed your life, hasn't it?
It did. Well, I just started practicing because after being non-active in tennis at all, I was really out of shape, and you know, I didn't want to really embarrass myself and be out there, you know, not being in good shape. So I started training again, and about 4 weeks into the training, I really felt like, you know, maybe I would like to compete again on tour, and I decided, and I've been training. I've been training really hard, and like Tim said, you know, I can hopefully do most of the running here today.
I tell you, he has been practicing. He's been practicing the word yours a lot, so I know that. But Kim, I know you're coming back for the US Open, but if you do change your mind and want to come back early, can I just point you to the front row there of the Roar Box, of the man you have to speak to if you want to come and play here at Wimbledon?
He already spoke to me, but hopefully I can be here next year. But I'm just very happy to be here today, and it's a real honor, so thank you very much.
Yeah. We're very happy to see you. And Tim, this is a special place for you, isn't it?
Yeah, as Andre said, it's such a special place for every tennis player, and you know, it's certainly an amazing addition to have the roof, and on a lovely warm sunny day like this, I'm glad we've got it.
Now, how are you guys? Have you been practicing hard? You look incredibly fit, Stephanie.
Oh, that just looks like it. No, we've been trying to prepare for it, not quite with the same ambition as Kim, trying to come back after we started, but it's been actually fun for us to kind of find our way back a little bit into tennis.
What does this court mean to you, Andre?
Oh, this means the world to me. This is the stage of my first triumph, and something I'll never forget, and I got to go have a special dance with my beautiful bride here that year, because she won as well, but they canceled the dance that year, which I wasn't too thrilled. Oh. Bummer. So that delayed my plans for about 7 years, you know. Getting ready here was something I was excited about. I started practicing real hard, then they told me I was playing Tim, and I stopped practicing, so...
Do you have anything to say to that, too?
There's going to be a lot of drop shots.
And Steffi, what does this court mean to you? Because I've seen of many of your triumphs.
I came here when I was 12 years old, and I stood somewhere back there, and I, you know, it meant the world to me. I, you know, as a young girl, and now coming back, it's... There's no other place than center court in Wimbledon to be on, and so this is no, this is it. This is where, you know, I feel tennis is got all the tradition and the heritage, and to be here is amazing. I mean, I've obviously have a lot of special memories, and another one today.
Yeah, and of course Bob Boris is here. There he is, and shot. He's made it here. Another great champ. He's on the screen. I'm not sure where. Got a message for him, Andre?
What's up, Boris?
Where are you sitting?
Oh, there you are. He's made it to the Roar Box, you say.
Very nice.
Excellent. So you're really looking forward to it. And who's going to be, I don't know who the boss is at home, but who's going to be the captain on court here?
Okay, I defer to 22 slams. I defer. So she moves better than me, looks better than me, does everything better than me. I'm just happy to be here.
Anyway, I know you really want to get psyched up and get ready and maybe have a cup of tea, whatever you're going to do. Anyway, we'll welcome you back onto court under the closed roof. Thanks very much, ladies and gentlemen, Andre, Steffi, Tim and Kim. Isn't it wonderful to see them back on this famous court? Now, just before we start the closing of the roof, we want to hear from a man who has been really the dominant force on this court in recent years. Just 2 years ago, he equaled the amazing record of Bjorn Borg by winning 5 consecutive Wimbledon crowns. Now, he did want to be here today, but he's got some urgent business in Madrid. He's playing the final of the Masters event over there against a certain Rafael Nadal. But here's a message from the genius with the racket, Roger Federer.
Well, I just think it's a good idea that we have the possibility to play also even when it rains, because, you know, so often do we just wait around, the media waits, the fans wait, and I know that can be fun too, but maybe after a few days you want to see a match, and I think that's why it's so great to have that opportunity now, and, you know, so there will always be matches at Wimbledon, except obviously Middle Sunday, and I'm very excited to see how it's going to really work, even though I have a good idea because I've played in Halle in Germany the years before, and they had actually a sliding roof already, and it worked perfectly fine. But it's, for me, really nice just to see that Wimbledon is taking such a big step in the right direction, and I'm sure that all the players are really excited to be coming back.
Thank you, Roger, and we are looking forward to welcoming him back here this summer. Well, it's only next month now, isn't it? Right, now it is time to start the closing of the roof. It will take about 8 or 9 minutes, so during that time we're going to be entertained by three outstanding musical acts. Joining us today is the new teenage singing sensation. There are four young men who have gone from success to success, bridging the gap between pop music and classical music. And they are joined by an award-winning artist, a woman who is changing the face of opera singing. Would you please give them a very warm welcome onto the center court? Farrell Smith, Blake, and Catherine Jenkins. Welcome indeed to Center Court. So this now signals the start of the closing of the roof. So if I might ask you, Catherine and Farrell, to take the stage. And so now, as Farrell and Catherine will start to sing, you'll see now that the roof is... Thank you to Farrell and to Catherine. Well, I'm now joined by one of the men who's had the key role in making this roof happen, the chief executive of the All England Club, Ian Ritchie. Ian, how long in the making was this?
Well, I think the planning process, obviously, over several years, and the construction itself over 3 years, because we've had to stop every summer for a bit of a do to protect the building. So a long time process.
Yes, we can see it now, you know, how long it took, and really you had to almost rebuild it from the bottom up.
Well, you're taking a 1922 building and refurbishing it from the foundations right up to the roof, but hopefully trying to keep the feeling of the centre court as well as modernising it.
Yes, I know that was important to you, but everyone's asking, you know, what's going to happen? Is it going to change the order of play? Will we see night matches here like we have at the Australian Open?
No, we see this as an outdoor summer tournament, and the roof is an insurance, so we still want to play with the roof open. We're hoping, of course, this year that we'll get 2 weeks of unalloyed sunshine.
Bound to, I'm sure. But if it does start raining, from the time it rains, how soon can play start?
Well, as you were saying earlier, it takes about 9 or 10 minutes for the roof to close, but then we've got to allow 20 or 30 minutes to get the air conditioning right, the air management systems, so that the court is bone dry.
Okay, well, that's great news. Thanks very much, Ian. Well, as you can see, the roof is still closing. We're now ready for a rousing finale, and I'm turning now over to the guys who are on the podium. Enjoy this. It's Blake.
Mm-hmm.
officially closed, and it's our first chance to see this magnificent structure, a folding fabric concertina which, being translucent, gives an open feel even when it's closed. The 87-year-old centre court has been transformed and now is ready to welcome a new era of champions, legends and epic matches. So that is it. It is now officially closed, ladies and gentlemen. As you heard, it probably takes about 20 minutes for the court surface to be ready for tennis, but we've got plenty more to entertain you, and I'm going to hand straight back to Blake for Hallelujah. That was terrific. Our thanks to Blake. And now would you welcome back to the podium a youngster who has really been taking the classical world by storm, Farrell Smith. Thanks to Farrell, that was wonderful. The good news for you guys is I'm not going to sing, don't worry, I'm not coming up here to sing. But Catherine, it's lovely to see you here on Centre Court. It is wonderful, and I know you know these guys very well, Farrell and Blake. They were special guests on your tour. She's a real talent, isn't she?
She is, and so young, and obviously a great voice. Mm. But the confidence that she has, you know, this is such a big occasion, and she just thoroughly enjoys it.
Are you enjoying it?
I can't believe it. I'm so excited to be here. I am a genuine tennis fan. I have come and queued very early in the morning with my mum for tickets just to get in here in the past. So I can't believe I'm actually singing on Centre Court.
And your mum's here today.
She is. My mum and the family are up there, and they make sure they come every year. So yes, I think I'm in the good books that I brought them this time.
It is terrific. You say you enjoy tennis. Do you play tennis, and who's your favourite player?
Well, I think my mum and my favourite player would be Agassi.
Oh.
Sorry, Steffi. Well, that's really put me up.
And Boris, you meant to say. Yeah.
And Boris. Boris, I love you.
No, it is wonderful. And I know you're going to do a number of songs for us. What are you going to start with, Catherine?
I'm going to start with Time to Say Goodbye.
Okay. Oh, well, that won't be just for Boris then, will it? No, okay. All right. Catherine, thanks very much. I'll leave it.
Thank you. sì, lo so che sei con me, mia luna tu sei qui con me, mio sole tu sei qui con me, con me, con me.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you're all having a wonderful day. I have to tell you again how excited I am to be here. In actual fact, there is, you know, with this being history in the making at Centre Court, there is something I've always wanted to say. New balls, please. And I'd also like to explain to you why I'm wearing, I don't know if you can see, but I have dual flip-flops. They're sparkly, but still they're flip-flops all the same. I like to wear in heels, but I've been told I have to wear flats so that I don't make holes in the grass as I walk on, so please excuse me. Now I'd like to sing to you my next song. It's my classical version of the Dolly Parton song. How did you get away with it? It's obviously who you know. So now I'd like to sing to you my classical version of I Will Always Love You.
Già lo so
Thank you very much for telling me to go off now.
Explain something. When you were talking about your flat shoes, our director Paul panned down to mine, which aren't necessarily flat, so that's why everyone was laughing. Anyway, but thank you very much. It was wonderful, wasn't she? The marvellous Catherine Jenkins, ladies and gentlemen. Well, we have been told by the head groundsman, Eddie Seward, that the court is now ready for play, so we are getting the players, we're scurrying them from the locker room and getting them down courtside in just a moment. It will take a couple of minutes for the court to be dressed for this doubles match, but I can tell you there are three matches taking place this afternoon. We're going to start with the mixed doubles match. That will be followed by the men's singles, and then a ladies' singles will complete the afternoon. Each match will be the best of one set, first to six, as usual, and if it gets to six games all, then they will play a full tiebreak. While we await the players, I've just spotted up in the commentary box, just sitting alongside Boris there, and I think on this special occasion we should pay tribute to three amazing British champions who have won on this court, sitting side by side. Virginia, don't look so coy. I'm going to ask them to stand up. Our three British Wimbledon champions, Virginia Wade, Anne Jones, and Angela Mortimer. So wonderful scenes. Now, I hope you're all enjoying this afternoon. It really is a historic day to have this roof. I think everyone wondered what it would look like. Well, it looks magnificent, and also I think it's going to make such a difference for the championships. I hear so often people, they often just get a centre court ticket once in their lifetime. They come along here and maybe not see a ball hit. Well, that will never happen again. You can thoroughly enjoy your centre court experience. So time for me to take a brief break, but I'm going to hand over now to our commentators who are waiting in the commentary box. If you ever wondered where the BBC commentary box is, just in that little window just to the side of the big screen. And our commentators today are John Lloyd and Andrew Castle. So on BBC I, they're going to take you through this match, but I believe the players are about ready. So keep an eye on the doors. They'll be making their way out soon. Thank you.
Thank you. saw Tim the other day extremely nervous about how well he was going to play, but I understand that as the big day has dawned, he's been playing an awful lot better. I heard he played against Pat Cash extremely well yesterday, so... Oh yeah, we must do all our photographs first. This is quite a historic moment, isn't it? The opening of the new centre court with a new roof and four stellar players to begin with. Are they changing ends?
Ooh, tactical.
Oh, there's more pictures. Oh. Cameraman's changing camera now. So the players have to wait. 15,000 people here in Centre Court, and they'll be eager to see some tennis now. We've had wonderful entertainment here with Catherine Jenkins and Farrell Smith and Blake. Can't promise you that every time the roof gets closed here on Centre Court, which is a shame. But it was at 2:47 exactly that the roof closed. The time now 3:17, and the warm-up begins in this mixed doubles. Just a pro set. Thought it was the first to eight. Pro set. We might be up to six. To be quite honest, we just don't know. It's whatever the play. Okay, well they've changed that. First to six. Right, let's have a look at Mr. and Mrs. Agassi first. You won't see too big a forehands on both sides of them there. Agassi's just wiped a backhand out, cross court right at Tim there. Just to sort of set the scene nice and early.
Yeah, so far, Agassi hasn't... Every ball has been hit straight in the middle of the strings and hasn't missed one yet.
No.
Timing impeccable as ever. I asked him actually in the locker, I just said, you know, just on the brief hits, when the roof has come over, do you think there'll be any difference? And he said, well, it's difficult for me to judge because I haven't so long since I've played here. Obviously it'd be tough for me to tell, but he, you know, there will be a difference on the speed of the court when the roof is closed. Even in the Australian Open, where it's a hard court surface, the speed does change when the roof is closed. So it'll be interesting to see what the players think about it afterwards.
Steffi was saying that she came here first as a 12-year-old, as a spectator. She came here in 1984 as a 15-year-old. And, well, she was in 9 singles finals here. She won titles in 88, 89, 91, 92, 93, 95 and 96. Absolutely extraordinary record. And at 39 years of age now, both Andre and Steffi. And it's a chance for many people here and watching on TV to see one of the game's legends sort of in the flesh, really. I mean, this is a name that was at the very top of the game for well over a decade. Phenomenal player. And her game based... largely on a massive forehand and a very underestimated backhand as well, and just a charming person as well. A word for everybody.
Well, I think you could definitely, there's a strong case for her being the greatest woman player of all time with her record.
Well, do you remember 1988? She won all four Grand Slams and then Olympic gold as well.
Exactly.
In Seoul.
Unbelievable.
And that's a year that's unlikely to be repeated. She joined Margaret Court and Mo Connolly, Little Mo, as a holder of the Grand Slam, and her husband won Olympic gold as well. So you'd imagine their two kids feel the weight of expectation, I would have thought, to be fine tennis players. I don't know whether they do play or not yet. They're still young. I bet they do, though.
Bit of a see Kim Clijsters there, which is going to be very interesting, her comeback as well. I mean, we just did some interviews today with Belgian TV, who were absolutely fascinated and asking whether they think she can come back to be number one or top 10 or this sort of stuff. And I think she will get back into the top 10. It'll take a bit of time, but I think she's got enough class. Was a tremendous player, stopped very young in her career, obviously, to get married and have a family. And I think now she's very eager to come back. She's been training very hard, and it's going to take her a while, but I see no reason why she can't get back. She's such a good player.
She's only 25.
Exactly.
She's 25 years of age. She had Steffi Graf posters on her wall at home. Steffi was a a hero of hers growing up. But, she has faced Steffi on this court, actually, and lost 6-2, 6-2, round 16. US Open champion Kim Clijsters, just one Grand Slam. It was her fourth Grand Slam final that she actually won. She was beginning to get a reputation as somebody who couldn't quite take that final step. Very similar, actually, to Andre Agassi, who finally won here in 1992, having had chances, especially in 1990 at the French Open final. Everyone thought he'd beat Andres Gomez, but he didn't. And the US Open as well, a couple of US Open. So it was on their fourth attempt that they won. The joy. Remember the joy of Agassi when he saw Ivanisic succumb, really, at the end of that five-set match in 1992. Fabulous.
And on paper, this is a little bit of an unfair match when you think of it. 30 Grand Slams up one end and one up the other.
Yeah, and gold medals.
Yeah, exactly.
Tim only won a silver in the doubles Jimmy. In 1996 with Neil Broad. But people, I think, forget actually that he was a French Open semi-finalist, Tim, and in 2004 also US Open semi-finalist. So six semi-finals at Grand Slam. What a shame for him that he wasn't quite able to go ahead and play in a Grand Slam final. I thought it was his destiny. I think many people thought it was his destiny. To go ahead and play a final here at Wimbledon, but not to be. If Sampras hadn't been around, you know, maybe it would have been possible. I mean, mind you, how many slams would Andre Agassi have won? He won eight. Good looking serve from Kim. Davis Cup lineup looking for September. You're playing against Poland. Are you taking a close look at Tim Henman here?
Well, yeah, I read in the paper that he says he hasn't missed it, tennis that is, at all.
No.
And enjoyed sort of getting ready for this, but then he'll put the rackets away again for a while. So,
ladies and gentlemen, team of Steffi Graf, Andre Agassi won the toss and chose to receive.
Agassi playing too many doubles over the course of his career, actually, because he just practiced his move to the net after serving.
Exactly.
It was a very rare move indeed.
Yeah, we're going to have to be interested to watch that, see how he serves and volleys. If he doesn't get into the net quick enough, I'm sure his missus will give him a bit of an evil look.
And Steffi have got two children. They've got Jaden Gill, 7 years old, and Jazz, who's five. And they don't remember the tennis that mum and dad used to play. I'm sure there's one or two DVDs at home of the highlights, but this is quite special to see Andre and Steffi taking the court together as a celebration of the opening. We're closing at the roof here on centre court.
Tim Henman to serve.
Rightly so. It's Tim Henman to serve the first ball. In anger, and here it is, the first ball under the roof at Wimbledon.
Good enough.
Somebody should grab that ball as a memento.
Let Kisivis.
He's still as upset now as he ever was when he misses a return. Doesn't like that. Mistiming a backhand? Unheard of. Celebration with a Henman loss of serve. Everything that he's been fearing whilst practicing over the last few weeks. A generous call there on the second serve. That's how he got a home call at Wimbledon, isn't it? Ooh, tactics here. Take the ball earlier. Tim just confirming in full earshot of Alison Lang in the chair that nobody's actually going to serve a double fault here, so don't worry, because he certainly did serve one, didn't it?
Andre,
it looked very, very dodgy. Yeah, I guess he's saying. Never thought we'd say that again on centre court.
No.
So that's a real pleasure.
He served volleys here.
No respect. She's not budging.
That'll teach you.
Did you know? 15-all.
Tim was very concerned to be seen in a positive light, wasn't he? His tennis and Andre beforehand, John, you were in the changing room.
Yeah, they were both very nervous.
Getting the ball fantastically well.
Yep.
Maybe the best forehand he's ever hit.
This is just the beauty.
They're very close, aren't they, Andre and Steffi? They've had a kiss to celebrate the winning of 1 point. They've had holding hands.
Game. Agassi and Graf. One game all. Kim Clijsters to serve.
Tim wouldn't be used to this, for someone serving and staying back.
Look at those rallies. Two players have given up.
Battle of the forehands here. This is going to be interesting.
Wake up.
Fifteen love.
Tidy forehands out there.
Tim knew that one was coming.
Henman handled this very well, didn't he? Look at the speed of this. Oh no, that one was the one that went out. That was joy. Some pretty good speed on that first serve from Kim Clijsters.
In game, Henman Clijsters.
Yes, this roof has two major sections. It's got nine bays of fabric in total between them. It's 5,200 square meters of waterproof and flexible fabric, and it's just the most beautiful feat of engineering, isn't it, Don? I mean, it looks absolutely fantastic. And the light seems good in here, doesn't it? Nobody's the slightest bit worried about that. It's just a spectacular thing to look at.
It really is. It's amazing. This should have been done, in my opinion, quite a few years ago. I'm so glad that women have finally put the roof in, and I think this will now put the pressure on the French Open and the US Open to also put the roofs in. We've got it at the Australian Open, and to my mind, there shouldn't be an occasion in today's modern world with the money that these Grand Slams make where there should be days where there is no play. It should not happen.
That's a thing of the past for everybody in here. 15,000 people in the house capacity, increased by 1,200. Here's Steffi Graf to serve.
expert would say that again either. Get out of the way!
Love the team.
Sweet little contest between Andre and Tim here, particularly. Many misses on that side. Steffi Graf forehand always looked a sort of an awkward looking shot in some ways, looked like she was going to hit it late but never did.
Never.
Had to be one of the great forehands of all time on the women's side,
and always set up with that lovely slice backhand, wasn't it?
She could 14. Certainly have given Andre a bit of a bad look for missing that one, but she didn't.
Yeah, mister, you're about to lose my serve for me.
Yeah, what's going on?
They've held hands, they've had a bit of a kiss as well, and why not? Steffi saved a couple of break points, and this is her reward. They probably don't play very often together, do they, in a situation like this with people watching. I mean, they might hit ball, I mean, they're bound to practice, but to actually be out here in front of 15,000 people, revisiting old memories. I mean, I assume they've got a court at home, John.
I presume so.
One of every surface.
Very solid volley.
I can see what was going to change.
Yeah.
30. 40-13.
Does he see the ball well still, or what? I mean, honestly. And what a pickup from Henman as well. I mean, that was rocketed. You won't see one quicker.
Unbelievable.
And look at the pickup. Very nice.
Advantage, Agassi.
Comforting hand on the shoulder as Henman faces a break point, as Steffi Graf had in the previous game.
Team Agassi, Mr. Graf. Agassi, Mr. Graf, lead 3-2.
Agassi's last performance here was in 2006. He was last at Wimbledon. It's not that long ago, frankly. It's just 3 years ago. He lost to Rafael Nadal in the third round. No disgrace, but I think he realised that enough was enough. 39 years of age now, so 36 when he stopped. That's a long time for a professional tennis player to play on. To anybody to get into their 30s now is quite a rarity.
Just a couple of shots that we saw in that last game with the ground strokes. He's just, it's so compact both sides, such short backswings. Just doesn't look like he's going to miss. Takes the ball so early. Must have been an absolute nightmare to even think about coming into the net against him. Oh. Because the ball comes back at you so fast and so hard.
And the other shot that he had against people who were at the net against him was that lob at any moment with that same compact swing. You
could
throw it up into the air and over your head. So really just good fun watching him play.
Love.
Think of the Agassi-Sampras rivalry that really sustained men's tennis in the mid-90s. Breathtaking tennis.
Love.
Talking about hitting a lot of drop shots against each other, they wanted to torture themselves, and there we saw Henman trying to drop shot Agassi. Didn't work though.
40 love.
Henman wants the whole guy, and there isn't any. No. Hawkeye will be available for the championships though.
Come on, baby.
15 love. Thirty love. 40 love.
You realise how rare some of these shots are now that Tim has retired. How rare at the top of the game little handsy shots like that drop volley he played on the backhand side are nowadays.
Game. Four games to crew.
Nice game there from Kim Clijsters. Certainly some, a lot of pace on that first serve. She's going to try and really time her sort of comeback to really be in the best shape that she can be for the US Open. She's going to play a few lead-up tournaments before the US Open, and I think, you know, she wouldn't be coming back unless she felt like she could be a force again.
You have to think that she's thinking top four or five.
I think so too. Yeah, I'm sure she's looking at the state of the women's game right now and thinking, well, there's definitely some spots in there for me, because it's not a very settled top 10 in the women's game right
not
now. It seems to change about every 3 weeks who's the new number one.
Safina at the moment. Safina.
Still hasn't won a Grand Slam, though, Safina.
No, exactly.
It's wide open, really.
Sharapova, we understand, is coming
supposed
back.
Supposed to be coming back.
That's good news. She's had terrible shoulder problems, yeah, hasn't she? I mean, do you think that could have been because she played so much as a kid? 17 years old when she won Wimbledon, Sharapova. See, it does take its toll eventually, but hopefully she'll have a full career now. But here's Steffi. She knows something about winning all these big tournaments. My goodness me. New tennis balls here for Steffi.
Out. 15 love.
Lovely rally there. Steffi hitting to Tim Henman at the net. Tim's following so solid. And dirty. Especially when she hits a winner. Wonderful. Got married in 1991, so the passion's still alive.
Forty-thirteen. deuce. Advantage, Mrs. Graf. Game, Agassi, Mrs. Graf. Agassi, Mrs. Graf, lead 5-3.
Sue, thank you. It is an absolutely brilliant match. Thoroughly enjoyable entertainment here. Tim Henman serving to stay in the set. And that'll be a relief for him. A missed forehand from Steffi Graf. Now, what a rarity that was when she was on the way to 7 Wimbledon titles. It's an indoor match. And what a way for this inauguration to take place, this opening of the new centre court, as it were. Lovely tennis. 15 love. I don't know how Mr. and Mrs. Agassi will be if they start losing a lot of points, but there's certainly been a lot of emotion between them in the first 8 games of this set. Just under half an hour played. They must have had 4 kisses and at least 3 hand holdings.
30-15.
And just such a pleasure to welcome these champions back onto this court. Yeah. And clearly they're having a nice time.
Yeah, a lot of smooching going on. He's belted a few huge returns off both sides.
30 all.
He's just had a lovely time being back on the court where he won his first Grand Slam back in 1992. Do you remember the match against Goran Ivanisevic? He looked a little different then. Was looking at that one in a slightly concerned manner, but the backhand volley was good.
Someone shout out, give us an ace, Tim.
Oh, jeepers. Mistimed that one.
Yes, that's,
yikes.
That is painful.
Well, she's laughing. Yes. Steffi taking a stern sort of view of that one. Yes, he's so embarrassed, Agassi, that he should be.
Kim, you okay?
The trouble is, even if Kim is not okay, she probably wouldn't share that now. But how did he con that one? Does not know how to hit the ball softly, does he?
No.
Really loves to hit the ball hard. When he came out as a 14-year-old practicing with the professionals, he was hitting the ball like this. Incredible.
Advantage. Agassi, Mrs. Graf, lead 5-3.
4.
Yes, this roof has two sections. It's got 9 bays of fabric, and there are 10 trusses of 75 meters across the court. Those trusses that you can see there, going sort of right to left as you look at the screen. They're wider than a football pitch, each one of them. So there's around about 1,000 tons of roof and mechanicals up there, and that's why this court, designed and built in 1922, had to go through so much refurbishment, literally years, and what a feat of engineering it is. As well as getting the roof across, because this is a natural surface, it's grass, there has to be a very complex air management system in here. So the roof takes 9 minutes to close, and then it's 20 to 30 minutes while the air is changed in here. There's 193,000 litres of air-conditioned air which has to come into this new bowl in order for the conditions to be perfect. So 24 degrees Celsius or thereabouts, and 50% humidity is what they're after. So those are all the technical specifications. Just so we can have some lovely indoor tennis and guaranteed tennis. And this is the opening match under the roof. Just a one set of this, so Agassi serving for the match.
Serving and staying back.
But Andre Agassi against Tim Henman next. Looking forward to that already.
I think Agassi's got the feel for this.
Yours.
Shot in.
Love 13.
What a return.
Love 14. Game,
Clisters,
5 games old.
sorry, darling, I think was what he was saying.
Yeah.
It's going to be so interesting, isn't it, to see Kim Clijsters back on court as a regular pro. She's only 25 years of age, twice a semi-finalist at Wimbledon, a former US Open champion, serving at 5-all.
The gap there.
Just caught the top of the net. Andre's backhand.
15-15.
Box.
Oh. Oh. That you all.
Nice serve, body serve.
Oh.
Her advantage in places.
So three games in a row for Henman and Clisters. They were 5-3 down, they're now 6-5 up here on the opening day, if you will, or the closing day, whichever way you want to look at it, of this new centre court. It's 16 metres, in case you're wondering if there's room for a lob, 16 metres from the trusses down to the court surface, and the roof is just a little higher than it was before, but 16 metres is plenty when it comes to lobs. Of course, there's going to be one or two that find their way up there and probably hit one of these magnificent struts, but what an operation it was getting those things up there. They had a 1,000-ton crane that did the work. So Henman's having a quick look and making sure everything's okay. And it's a classic Wimbledon day, really. Certainly it was a classic Wimbledon morning, which had Eddie C with the groundsman slightly concerned, and Andrew Jarrett as well, and no doubt the committee. It was windy. One moment it was sunny, the next it was raining. But all those sort of variables taken out. This new roof here. Such a familiar service motion, isn't it? And such a familiar forehand that she has as well. What a lovely thing it is to see her back. Always had such a high ball toss, but never mistimed the serve. Didn't even matter if it was windy or bad condition. Of course,
well done, John.
Yeah, it had to happen, didn't it?
40-15.
Seems so strange to be here, doesn't it, in May, with the court all dressed up and a full house in, 15,000 people the last time we were here, July the 6th last year, Federer, Nadal. And whilst we're enjoying this mixed doubles to celebrate the roof on centre court, Federer and Nadal are playing in Madrid. Sue Barker will bring you up to date with the score in the final of Madrid in a few minutes time after this. Tie break now after 40 minutes of play. Talk, wasn't there, that Agassi and Graf, Mr. and Mrs. Agassi, could play mixed doubles somewhere. And this is the moment they've chosen.
One.
Yeah, well, there were rumours that
the
last couple of years Andre played that he was going to try and get Steffi to play with in the mixed doubles at the French, perhaps, but it never happened.
Two
all. It's not easy to find the time, isn't it, with two children at home. Jaden Gill is 7 years old and little Jazz is just five.
Three, two, Henman, Clisters.
Kim Clisters has got a little girl at home, Jada Ellie. Just over a year old.
Two,
and then
Mrs.
Clisters. I know, I love it. In, but so quick around the court still. This. Not bad, that.
In here are very well controlled, and they need to be, because Henman is puffing hard at the end of that point, and so are all of the players. It's a match point for Henman and Clisters. Beautifully played match. Tremendous ovation for all these players. Two truly great champions in Andre Agassi and his wife Steffi Graf. Magnificent in the past and magnificent to watch even now. Henman and Clisters win the set, but that's pretty secondary stuff. The entertainment was first class.
I can say is thank you so much. I mean, great tennis and wonderful entertainment as well. Let's speak to the victors first. It was a close one though, Tim.
I'm in trouble for the singles now. It was hard work covering half the court, and now I've got to get out there and cover the full court, so.
You had great help from your partner. You're playing very well, Kim. I can see why you want to come back.
Well, it was just a lot of fun. I just want to tell you right now, I think the court plays really well. There's no problems with the roof or anything, so it was fun to be out here.
That is great news for all those up there. Tim, you've probably spent more than your fair share of time out here. How did it feel to you here?
Yeah, it's fantastic. I mean, everybody who arrived here today saw it's a pretty miserable day outside. It's been raining, it's windy, and it's cold, and you've got this roof, and once they've closed it, it's just the most fantastic playing conditions. As Kim said, it's a lot warmer than it was, but there's no moisture on the court. You've got very sure footing, so there'll be no excuses to do with the court.
And I can see that you thoroughly enjoyed playing Mr. and Mrs. Agassi.
Absolutely, yeah. You don't get that chance too many often, and they'll never get a chance of revenge.
Well, I'll head over and have a word with Andre and Steffi. We thought it was such a lovely way to start. Steffi comes up and gives you a kiss. It was lovely.
That's what we always do.
That's the way it all started, right?
Exactly. And there, we're reliving it again. There we are. But it was fantastic. But did you enjoy it as much as we all did?
I just want to say that my wife is so much better at tennis than Tim's wife. Hi, Lucy.
But did it feel good for you out there?
Needless to say, it's pretty nerve-wracking, such a special occasion, and to come out here and you're trying hard just to not injure yourself, really. But we quickly settled in and just enjoyed it so much. I don't know if I've ever smiled this much on a tennis court.
Well, great points, and I tell you, that forehand is still there.
Yeah, I'm just asking for the other wild card, maybe.
Oh, is that a yes? I think it is. They've given you a yes, absolutely. Absolutely. And just a final word, how did you think the roof was?
Oh, this was amazing. I tell you, I have to stretch my memory to go back 3 years last time I played here, but the way the ball sounds in here for a player is going to add so much intensity to the match. I mean, I think you're in for some real battles, and my God, I think this is going to only add to everything we've ever had here.
I think we can now get a reaction from Tim's wife, because we found Lucy. There she is, Lucy. Don't worry about it. Honestly, he didn't mean it. But no, it was fantastic. And you, Steffi, did you enjoy it? Was it lovely to be back on center?
Oh, I've been so nervous the last few hours, and then actually starting to hit, it just felt amazing. And this is spectacular. That was a real treat to be on the court today.
Yeah, and we look forward to seeing you both back in action later this afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, Andre and Steffi. Your appreciation again for Tim and Kim, Andre and Steffi. Well, now you can probably see that the ground staff are on the court. They're going to take a couple of minutes to change the net from the doubles net to the singles net. It doesn't take that long. I think it's just to give the boys a little bit of a break, because Tim and Andre will be back in a few moments. Now, I'll tell you to stay in your seats, because we do have a very special guest coming on centre court in just a moment. But we've also got a wonderful guest returning to centre court. Please give her a warm welcome back, the marvellous Catherine Jenkins.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. The last song I'd like to sing for you today was actually requested by the All England Lawn Tennis. Oh, I've got it wrong. I knew I was going to do that. You know what I mean. So this is a song that I actually always associate with going out to sing in places like Iraq and Afghanistan. And I wanted to dedicate this last song. I'm sure you've seen whilst you've been walking around all our wonderful servicemen and servicewomen who are doing such a great job today. And I think we should dedicate to them and say thank you for doing such a great job.
Thank you.
Catherine Jenkins, thank you for making this such a very special occasion. Thank you so much. Well, we heard from Roger Federer a short time ago. He's playing in the Madrid Masters final. He is playing Rafael Nadal. Now, Rafael Nadal came through an epic match yesterday, a semi-final match against Novak Djokovic. It took almost 4 hours. I can tell you that Federer has won the first set against Rafa. But as we know, they do like to enjoy long, long matches. I'll keep you up to date with that one. But Rafa also wanted to be here, but I thought only fitting that we should hear from Wimbledon's reigning champion. So Rafa sent us this short message.
Hello, everybody. I'm very happy to come back to Wimbledon. Yeah, I had the best memories of my career to be here. And yeah, I'm really excited to try the new center court with the roof. So I hope to see you there. See you soon.
We will see him then, Rafael Nadal. We look forward to seeing him next month, but we're also looking forward to seeing my next guest on centre court. I know he's very keen to get out here to have a look at the roof, and I know he's very keen for you to raise the roof for him during the championships. He is Britain's number one, the world number three. Please welcome Andy Murray. Welcome, Andy. Lovely welcome. It's a walk I know you're used to already. What's the first impressions of the roof?
No, it's beautiful. I hadn't seen it before today, so no, it looks really nice compared with most roofs.
And Andy and I were just standing outside. We looked outside, and I can tell you, it is raining. So this is exactly what we've coming here for, to get continuous tennis. Now talk a little bit about your year. I mean, it's just going from strength to strength. How does it feel to be number three now?
Oh, it's been good. I started the year very well. You know, I played very well at the end of last year as well, but last month or so hasn't been as good, and I'll try and get better before Wimbledon starts.
Yes, the clay court season, then we go into the grass court season. But you must have some great memories of playing on this court, even though it's only early in your career.
Yeah, well, one of the best matches of last year for me was against Gasquet. When I came back from a couple of sets down, played a five-set match against Nalbandian here the first time I played, and yeah, the atmosphere is great. And I think with the roof on as well, I think the atmosphere is even better when the roofs are closed. So no, I really look forward to playing this year.
And I might give a warning to anyone in about the front row over here, because we're going to remind you of what happened in Andy's match against Richard last year. Do you remember what happened, that epic point?
Yeah, almost almost ended up in that row right there. I got a little bit excited after this point.
Great memories. And it's a wonderful atmosphere, and I think it's going to be even greater under this roof.
Yeah, no, I mean, all the indoor tournaments that I've played, you know, you go to concerts and what's not. I mean, the atmosphere in here is always great, but I think when the roof's on as well, it kind of gets trapped in even more. So yeah, it should be interesting to play a long five-setter in this one.
Now everyone's talking about, oh, he's going to win a Grand Slam, and everyone's saying, oh, he might win the US Open. Everyone here, all of us, want you to win it here, Andy. It would be special, wouldn't it?
Yeah, I mean, this is, I think tomorrow's Fred Perry's 100th birthday, so yeah, it would be special to win it this year, but I'm going to give it my best shot, but I'll try not to put too much pressure on myself.
No, and of course we won't either, not much, anyway. Anyway, Andy, stand by, because we're going to continue our conversation, but I'm going to welcome back those two guys. I hope they've had sufficient rest. Please welcome back Tim and Andre. And while they greet Tim, I was just saying, we're not putting much pressure on him, but we put enough pressure on you.
Yeah, a little bit. But I think we've all seen by Andy's performances, not only in the last 12 months, but in his whole career so far, he's dealt with sort of every obstacle that's been put in front of him. And there's no doubt in my mind that, you know, he can win this tournament one day and other Grand Slams, because I think his performances have been that good.
Yeah. And Andy and I were outside. Andy, just you can tell him now, who's your favourite player ever?
Growing up, it was Andre, actually. I had the little denim shorts with the pink cycling shorts underneath, and yeah, you know, I had a cap with the long blonde dreads attached to it and stuff. So no, I was a big Andre fan. Obviously, supported Tim a lot as well.
But. Yeah, I was going to say your second favourite is Tim.
Yeah.
Andre, what do you make of his style of play?
Well, let me tell you, I think his game translates so well to so many surfaces, so many players. Not that he needs any more pressure coming here, but I got to put him certainly as one of the favorites, not just here, but for many, many slams to come.
Yeah. And a great tactician on court.
No question. He seems to understand the court quite instinctively, and even though he walks really slow, his movement is... he's just a bottle of energy, isn't he, when he walks in? But he's... But he moves like I do sometimes in my dreams. So,
and he obviously has great taste as well. Picking you as his favorite.
Yeah, the hair ponytail pink. I'm not sure. I question his judgment a little bit.
Are you ready for this one now?
No.
Are you ready, Tim?
No.
Okay. Who's going to win, Andy? Who's your money on?
I'll take Tim.
Okay, guys, I'll let you do a warm-up. Only a short one. I know you're already warmed up. So Tim, what was your favourite match, and what made you sort of admire Andre?
I think just sort of when I was growing up, he was probably the most charismatic player on the tour, and just, you know, like I say, with all the, you know, the long hair, the pink shorts, the... All those sorts of things were what, you know, what made me enjoy watching him. He had a bit of attitude on the court, and that was what I liked.
And of course, I mean, great eras that they've played in, but the era that you're playing in at the moment, I mean, there's some sensational players right at the top of the game.
Yeah, two of the best players of all time, maybe the two best. You know, Roger's probably going to win, you know, the 14 slam, you know, to equal Pete at some point, and Rafa's only 22 years old. He's already got 6 slams, so... And he's won on every surface as well. So I think they're two of the best players ever. And, you know, me and Novak are trying to catch them up.
Yeah, sort of bad era to be in, really. But anyway, it's probably enjoyable anyway. What about these guys? What are you? Well, I mean, talk about Tim, because you've obviously played alongside Tim in Davis Cup and other events. How do you rate his game?
Oh, I obviously watched Tim for a good 10 years here. You know, and then I got to know him when I started to play in the Davis Cup and went on the tour, and he is very, very funny guy, as you probably saw today, and more sort of relaxed atmosphere here, and he was definitely a great person to look up to.
Yeah, and our Davis Cup captain is in the commentary box today, so maybe watching, maybe calling Tim back, who knows? There he is over there. So what do you make of this? You know, there might be a few balls down the middle. What do you think?
Yeah, I heard both of them were saying they were struggling with their movement a little bit, but they both hit the ball great, so...
I'm sure that was aimed at you.
Yeah, it should be a good match.
Yeah, but it's sort of different in their era, wasn't it? I mean, we're safe here, I think.
Yeah. No, I used to love watching both of them play. Very different game styles. Tim obviously playing the more classical game, and Andre was, you know, probably one of the hardest hitters of the ball. So.
I'm just saying, boys, do you really need a 5-minute warm-up? Or, okay, yes, the answer is yes. Now. I knew there'd be someone who would try and do that. I think that answers your question, because we were talking about the lobs outside.
Yeah, the roof is a little bit low, but I'll try and keep it a little bit lower than that.
Okay, and I'm just hearing that Roger Federer over in the final won the first set. He's 4-3 up with a break of serve. So, I mean, that would be an amazing sort of comeback for Roger and a real boost to his confidence.
Yeah, I mean, he hasn't won a tournament this year, so obviously it'll be... Yeah, big for his confidence, but Rafa had a 4 hour and 10 minute match with Novak yesterday, so he's probably going to be a little bit tired, but yeah, be big for Roger for his confidence before the French Open.
Okay, and obviously next for you it's the French Open before the grass court season. When are you heading over there?
Leave on Tuesday night, take the train over there on Tuesday, and yeah, try and reach the second week is my goal there.
Sure it is. We look forward to it. Ladies and gentlemen, wish you good luck for the French Open. We look forward to seeing you out here. Ladies and gentlemen, Andy Murray. So we'll sit back and enjoy this singles match. I'll hand over to our commentary team. It's back to John and Andrew.
Sue, thank you very much indeed. Some raised eyebrows here from the Davis Cup captain in the commentary position here when he found that Andrew Murray was going over on Tuesday. That's early preparation, isn't it?
Very early.
French Open.
I expect him to stay in London, play on the clay in London for a couple of days, but well, it shows he means business, which he's a pro, and he knows what's best, and he obviously wants to get used to the conditions there, but that is pretty early.
Of course, the question that we really want to know the answer to, and perhaps you can help us with it, is he going to play Davis Cup in September against Poland at the Liverpool Echo Arena? Very important Davis Cup tie that you'll be captaining.
Yeah, well, I'm sure he'll play. I mean, we've had a few chats about it. It's not an easy schedule this year, the Davis Cup, and that one is, our next match is the week after the US Open, so it's... if he does well at the US Open, which I certainly expect him to, it's a quick turnaround, but you know, he's eager to play, and you know, we're playing at home again. It's not like it's an away trip somewhere. It's home in Liverpool, so I'm sure he'll play, and you know, quite frankly, we need him to play.
Yeah, it's against Poland, and I'm sure there are some tickets still available. It's about a 5,000 seat arena, yep. Isn't it, the Liverpool Echo?
Yeah.
So we've got about another 25 minutes or so of tennis here on BBC Two. The Manchester Athletics with Usain Bolt and friends will follow at 5 o'clock. But you can stay with us on the red button all the way through, because I know you'll want to be staying with a little bit of Andre versus Tim here. So one regular set. And after that, Steffi Graf, Andre's wife, will be playing against Kim Clijsters, who's making a comeback onto the tour this summer, we understand, and we'll be playing perhaps in some hardcourt tournaments leading up to the US Open as well. So there's a lot to come here, and this is going to be a very, very tasty match to watch under the roof of the centre court. See, one of the great advantages of having a roof is... I shouldn't say that about Sir Cliff, should I? Sir Cliff Richard singing to keep everybody entertained when the rains came down. But I don't think there's a keener tennis-playing member of this club than Cliff Richard. He absolutely loves the game. He's done a great deal for the game over the years as well.
Ladies and gentlemen, Andre Agassi won the
toss. Taking tennis to people in schools and leaving the equipment behind and sending coaches in on a regular basis as well. So, really is an expectant atmosphere here. The mixed doubles is out of the way, and now a very interesting singles between the 1992 champion Andre Agassi, an 8-time Grand Slam champion. A superstar in the game. Against four-time semi-finalist British legend Tim Henman, Agassi serving.
Love 15.
So naturally in position, doesn't he, Agassi, on both ground strokes, forehand and backhand.
30-all.
But he used to make that section of the court basically his domain, that sort of 3-4 feet either side of the middle of the baseline there, and would hug it. He would hit the ball on the baseline early,
30-40.
And basically his philosophy was that he would eventually take the legs out from his opponent by running them, and he basically commanded that area of the court.
Deuce.
And he'd say in long matches when players used to start going for winners from ridiculous positions, he knew he had them. Because that's when they were taking chances, because there was nothing left in the tank. Nice call there. I was asking him today whether he had any desire after this sort of practicing to play any more tennis. He said he's playing a senior event in October for Jim Courier, but he's doing that as a favour and doesn't think that he will play the senior tour, but never say never.
Well, my goodness, when he was on the regular tour, he was always in or out, wasn't he? I mean, there was nothing in between for him. He was either fully committed or he was ranked 150 or 200 in the world. He had to work his way back from injury and motivational issues on so many occasions, but every time he came back, there was another highlight.
Yep.
And I think he would probably agree that the highlight of his career came on this very court in 1992. He beat Goran Ivanisevic in the Wimbledon final and then sunk to his knees.
His son Jaden apparently is a great baseball player. He's not plays a bit of tennis, but baseball is his love. And Andre said he's got a incredible hand-eye coordination. Surprise, surprise.
Jerry Armstrong's in the chair.
I know it's your best one, Tim, but...
I know it's your best one, Tim, but I'm not going to change the call.
Oh!
He didn't expect that back.
What a shot that was for both of them. I mean, this forehand, that is pace.
30-15.
Good reflexes from Tim there.
One game on.
Just great hands from Tim Henman. Sunshine outside, no need for the roof, but we're going to leave it exactly where it is. It closed earlier on to a fanfare from Blake, from Farrell Smith, and from Catherine Jenkins as well. That can't be guaranteed every time the roof closes.
13 love.
But it's been a spectacular day. And the All England Club will take great note of what Tim Henman, who is on the committee here now, and Andre Agassi and the other players, Kim and Steffi, have to say about the playing conditions in here, because it's not just the roof which is the issue, it's the humidity and the air management that matters.
Well, the first thing is to me, whenever you see the centre court in general, and the roof the first day of play at Wimbledon, the first and second day, you normally see some slips, players slipping. We haven't seen that yet at all. And Tim just did a slight one there, but
40-15.
We haven't seen anybody, now whether they're not moving well enough to do that, I don't know.
That's always possible. Perhaps not pushing it quite like the likes of Nadal and some of the younger players would at this stage.
Game, Agassi. Agassi leads 2-1.
Plenty of fine sport coming away on the BBC at 5 o'clock on BBC Two. After this, you can stay with this match here. You've got Usain Bolt involved in the Manchester Road Races up there. That's going to be fantastic. Match of the Do day tonight, 10:30, BBC Two, Adrian Charles. I mean, the season's really hotting up now. And BBC One tomorrow night, Gabby Logan on Inside Sport. Actually, last week, Steffi and Andre were on that. What a captivating pair Steffi and Andre are. I had no idea that they were sort of close, and then suddenly it became... it was almost like a publicity stunt, wasn't it? You can't believe these two sort of legends of the game got together, married and two kids now. And it hardly surprises me that you tell me that their boy, their seven-year-old, is athletic and hitting the ball well on the baseball field.
Yeah, it was amazing when they got together, because you had the most charismatic sort of outgoing fella in Andre Agassi, and Steffi Graf, who was very shy, didn't like sort of, oh, there's Boris Becker there, didn't like the limelight. Next minute, they're going out and living Las Vegas of all places. It was sort of un-Steffi-like in some ways.
Charismatic pair. Tim Henman serving. 1-2 in this set.
Love 15.
I saw Tim in a traffic jam the other day, wound the window down and said, are you ready for Sunday? He says, not at all. He said, I played some 14-year-old at Bisham Abbey. I was 3-love down in 15 minutes yesterday, he said. Really hasn't been playing a lot of tennis. He's playing very well.
15-all. Thank you. 30-40.
Fairly sharp competitive edge to this match, no problem at all. Players will have talked about it. I mean, it's fun, but it's fun to compete. Henman won't like being break point down.
Deuce.
It's always difficult to find the tone when you're playing one of these matches. I mean, how seriously do you want to take it? Do you want to play some exhibition shots? Because they're going after each other here. It's fun. So lovely to see some serve and volley tennis, isn't it? You just don't see much of it these days in the men's pro game.
Deuce.
Pair of his wife's socks on, I think, there, John.
Yes.
Golf socks. Still built very strongly, Andre Agassi. Much wider than he may appear on TV. Much taller as well, almost 6 foot. Very wide, powerful. His father was an Olympic boxer.
Training regime with Gil Rose in Vegas, which now
advantage Henman.
Verdasco, we've seen the benefits of Verdasco since he started going there, how fit he is and running up those sand hills that they used to do for miles. Oh, well done. With Andre in the locker room before the match today, and he was something came up
two
on the TV set, a picture of Rafael Nadal, and he was raving about Rafa, talking about how he is a man that always gives credit to his opponents, always signs autographs. He said that how Rafa, after he won the French and then he came here and lost at Wimbledon, said that I want to win this tournament. And he said, Andre said, I thought he was joking. Yeah, he didn't. Andre said, I didn't think he had a chance of winning it, and look where he is now. Just thinks that Rafa Nadal is just a league apart from everybody.
15. Including Roger.
Well, even Roger, he just thinks that he's something special at his age, that he thinks he's going to go on to win, you know, many, many more Grand Slams.
Oh.
That's a ridiculous shot.
That's hand-eye coordination. That's what we talk about with this sort of element of the game. I mean, this is a skidding ball, fairly deep, and that whipped half volley. That's a rare ability.
Can't teach that.
Agassi leads 3-2.
Well, who would have thought this? Back in 1922, when this centre court moved here from Werpel Road, they thought it was a bit of a white elephant. It had 13,000 people who could get in. They just weren't sure what the attraction was going to be. And now, this huge refurbishment, a 1,000-ton roof, guaranteeing tennis. Took many years to get it organized, and this is the day that it all began. Fantastic. This will be the Olympic venue for 2012 in London for the tennis as well, and it's just about guaranteeing TV coverage and guaranteeing for the now 15,000 people that fit in here that they can actually see some tennis. It's very, very important to keep the All England and the championships themselves at the very forefront of sport. Big day, big year actually for tennis. We've got the tennis from Queen's Club 2 weeks before Wimbledon. That'll be live on the BBC. We've got the Davis Cup in September from the Liverpool Echo Arena. That's against Poland. And a wonderful event at the O2 at the end of the year in November. That's the top eight in the world. I used to call it the Masters. Many people still do. Masters Cup. So I don't know what the official name is anymore, but we'll be there. It's the top eight in the world. Stand by for that. That's a fabulous event. And news from Madrid. Federer has beaten Nadal. 6-4, 6-4. Not that much of a surprise seeing what Nadal went through yesterday against Djokovic, it has to be said.
Love 15.
That was the last singles match we saw here. It was July the 6th, the last men's singles match. The last awesome competition. And this is the first this year.
15-all. Thirty all.
Picking the spots with the serve in this game, Henman.
Soft hands from Henman. We've seen it so many times over the years. Wonderful pickup. Great understanding.
Three games all.
Just a few more minutes here. 5-5 is the time. We're with you for another few minutes before we head off to the athletics with Usain Bolt up in Manchester, the Manchester Road Races. We'll be on the red button if you want more of this tennis, and I think you might. I hope so.
Drive volleys from the baseline. You don't see that shot very often. Two of them.
Love 15.
Years ago in Las Vegas at the tournament there, I was watching
a
couple of matches, and he came and sat next to me, and he dissected the match, and his tactical knowledge and what he talked about with the players was unbelievable. He would make a tremendous coach if he ever decided to do that.
A shortage of power from Andre Agassi, and this keenly contested match continues. That's 3-all, 30-all.
First service.
No, that's just wide from Henman. A break point gone.
Deuce.
advantage, Agassi.
Oh, that's absolutely spectacular from Andre Agassi. 4-3, no breaks of serve. This entertaining match continues. And it's been wonderful to watch underneath the roof here on Centre Court, the new roof. But I'm sure the atmosphere out there has been wonderful as well, Sue.
Too many of those types of rallies.
15-all.
There were very few who could compete with Andre Agassi over the years. Sampras on his forehand side, he certainly could out-hit him. Courier on occasion. Chang could run a few down too. Agassi was sort of raised in the era of Lendl, wasn't he, as well? I mean, he goes all the way back, Agassi. 39 years of age now.
He won that one. What an era that was for American tennis, when you think of it. I mean, the competition 30, there. Michael Chang, probably the weakest of that four. He wasn't bad. Sampras, Courier, and Agassi.
Sampras with all his slams. And Courier won four and was undoubtedly world number one for some time. Two French.
Oh,
beautiful volley. Two French and two Australians for Courier.
40-15.
Chang just won the French. And Agassi with eight Grand Slams. But not a final at Slam level for Henman. What a shame that was after a brilliant career.
Okay, Henman.
Oh, that slice stays nice and low.
Four games on. Love 15.
Just play it. Just takes it right out of the air, doesn't he?
Yep.
And of course, with no wind in here now underneath the roof, he knows where the ball's going to be, so it is going to be. There are going to be conditions which favour certain 30, players. 50. Federer wouldn't mind at all if it's played indoors. Not as though he needs any help on the grass anyway.
First service. Agassi leads 5-4.
His retirement in 2006 at the US Open for Andre Agassi. He lost to Benjamin Becker there in the third round. He was finished, you know, done with it.
Yep.
Ready to move on with his life. It was 2007 at Wimbledon, but not on center court for Tim Henman, wasn't it?
Yeah, you know, there just comes a time, and you just know it's the right time. And obviously, a lot of times the press and the public try to influence that decision, you know, especially when you start losing matches. But it's personal. You have to, you know, when it's time, when a player starts to stop enjoying the practicing, and doesn't enjoy the challenge of going out there day after day, you know. But you don't like it when other people tell you when to stop.
There's Andrew Murray there on the left, and Kim Sears. They've been together a long time. Great partnership. Andy Murray, number three in the world, had a lovely chat with Sue Barker earlier on, just talking about how Andre Agassi was his favourite player growing up.
It's going to be very interesting to see how Andy Murray does at the French Open. Over five sets on clay, his least favourite surface, but has played pretty well on the clay court season so far. To miss many on that side. The backhand volley, certainly one of the best in the world when he played, no question.
It would still be one of the best in the world if it was out there now.
That's
but
right.
In a spot of bother here. It's a wry smile on Henman's face, and I'm not surprised. That really was a gift, wasn't it? A second serve at love 30, and Agassi misses the return. Competitive match, this.
Lucky that was called out right on the line.
Oh, spectacular forehand, really, what a treat. Not for Henman or Henman fans, though.
15-14.
He brings up a couple of match points, and here's a roar we haven't heard for a while. There's a wave of nostalgia going
13,
around
14.
Here.
First service.
Agassi Agassi was going to let fly with that forehand no matter what.
Agassi.
Forward match point now to Agassi, and where do you serve to a man who is almost certainly going to break the ball on the return? Oh!
One thing when you're when you are serve volleying against Agassi, you don't have to worry about the pace. You just, as long as you get your racket out in front, the pace is there.
Well, we knew we were in for a treat, didn't we, after the mixed doubles? That was terrific. Can you two guys come here? Andre, fantastic. You see, you should make a comeback yourself. It's only a few years you've been away. Or are you enjoying retirement too much?
You know, every time I watch these guys play now, I'm so thankful that I'm watching it. That's it. It was a pleasure to be out here for so many years, and it's a pleasure to watch the game get taken to new heights.
Yeah. Did it bring back memories, Tim? They were cheering you on. We thought you were going to come back.
I was trying. But no, it was such a great opportunity and an honor to play, back out on center court in these kind of new circumstances. And as everyone said so far, you know, the conditions are really fantastic. So it's been a great day.
Put the rackets away now, get the golf clubs out again, is it?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I'm golf fit, but I'm certainly not tennis fit.
And who are you playing golf with on Wednesday?
That's right, yes. I'm playing in the Pro-Am at Wentworth, and my partner is John Daly.
Ah! you won't win the longest drive competition there, I can tell you. But Andre also, I mean, it's fantastic, sort of. It's wonderful to see you back here, and does this sort of, I mean, I know it's wonderful memories for you and everything here, isn't it?
Oh, there's no question about it. And just to be a part of history, I mean, this is the day that we'll always remember, and I think it'll pay all the sports fans and tennis fans across the world back over and over again. And just to be here to sort of celebrate it was a privilege for me and for my wife. And, you know, my goodness, I couldn't ask for anything better.
I looked up the record books, you know. Do you know what your head-to-head was before today?
It was 2-2.
Okay. So you've won then?
I squared it up. That's right. No. Take that, Tim.
Oh, sorry.
That.
Isn't it 3-3?
I had 2-2.
We won the mixed.
It's a draw. Okay, it's a draw. Hold on, just stay here, guys, for a moment, because we have another special guest. We've dragged him down from the Royal Box. Another of your big favourites, I know. Please give him a warm welcome. The one and only Boris Becker. Boris. What did you make of these two guys out there today?
Thank God I wasn't out there, because you played amazing.
They did play fantastic, didn't they? What do you think of the roof?
Excellent. I was expecting a lot the last 5 years. Every summer we talked about the new roof and when it's going to be finished. I think the architect did an amazing job, and I think it's a great addition to the tournament.
Would you be tempted to make a comeback?
Well, there's still number one available. Of course, on the next roof, please invite me, so I'm going to play this. Yes.
Okay, it's fantastic. And these guys, I know they've retired only 2 or 3 years ago, but they played fantastic tennis. And I think it's the crowd. It's a sort of a different style of tennis as well, isn't it?
Well, it's not
today
that.
An exhibition style of tennis.
It's not that different yet. I think if it's one set, I think that these guys can still very much play with the best players today. But I think in the best of five match, I still would put my money on Nadal.
On that note, we'll let you go. Ladies and gentlemen, a big thank you to Boris and also to Tim and Andre. Fantastic tennis. I love teasing them, but really it was like turning the clock back. Fantastic tennis from Andre and Tim. Still more tennis to come though, and we've got two Grand Slam champions, two former world number ones. In fact, Steffi won the Wimbledon title on this court 7 times. So would you please welcome the ladies back onto court. Please welcome Kim Clijsters and Steffi Graf.
Steffi Graf, 7 times a champion on this court, up against Kim Clijsters. This is going to be a battle of two of the biggest forehands you've ever seen. And Steffi has seen her husband win against Tim Henman. And the celebration of this new centre court roof continues today. Played each other on this very court in 1999, round of 16, and Steffi won that one fairly comfortably, 6-2, 6-2. Everybody saluted Steffi Graf so much, of course, over the years, and particularly when she was playing 22 Grand Slam titles. But I wonder if we don't take great champions for granted. And the moment that they leave, you think, oh, well, she really was fantastic, because Martina seemed to be the one who people were saluting the most at that time. And of course, Martina was, you know, nine slams, or nine Wimbledons and all the rest of it. But Steffi's achievement of winning all four of the slams at least 4 times, that is unequalled.
I think you're absolutely right there with the description there of the two, because I think Martina, she was just more outgoing and publicised herself. I don't mean that in a way, but she was very happy to do interviews. Steffi was extremely shy. I mean, she was a tennis player, won her matches, and that was kind of it. So even though her record is the greatest of all time, I don't think people think of her as that, because there wasn't just enough written about her. There was at the time of the tournament, but there was nothing sort of off the court, and that people remember what they see, and they didn't see enough of Steffi in that way. And I think her record is absolutely astounding, what she achieved on all surfaces in the Grand Slams, and it's tough not to rate her the best of all time.
She was number one in the world for 377 weeks. it's an extraordinary thing. And of course, what overshadowed a couple of those years, rather, or was certainly a factor in the way people viewed her and her career, was Monica Seles and what happened to her in May 1991. She was stabbed, and that affected obviously her growth as a person and her tennis record. So that might have got in the way just a little bit as well.
Well, I think you're right there, but I think at that time Monica Seles had a good winning record against Steffi Graf, and people said she had her number. But you see, obviously we'll never know, but I think someone like Steffi, I'm not saying she wouldn't have lost to Monica again if that tragedy hadn't happened, but she would have found a way to change it up and certainly would have won her fair share. So I don't think that's really fair, but again, that's what I think some of the public think of.
Catherine Jenkins has done her work on centre court today, and now more than happy with mum, and I assume sister, to get into the wave here. And it should be coming around any time soon. Yes, lovely performance from her and from Farrell Smith earlier on, and from the man band, Blake. Classical boy band, if you like. Here's Kim Clijsters. She's only 25 years of age now. She wants to make a comeback, and you can understand why. A record like that, you know she's going to win an awful lot more tournaments. The only slam she won, only, was the US Open back in 2005. She suffered disappointment on three occasions before she won that. Disappointment in the form, usually, of Justine Hénin-Hardenne, who was so difficult to deal with. I just think she wanted to find something else in her life and then perhaps come back to the tennis. I'm sure that wasn't always the plan, but she's ready now.
Yeah, she did get nervous in those Grand Slams, didn't play at her best, but when she finally won that first one, obviously the first one is always the toughest to achieve, and I think if she ever gets in that position again after this comeback, and that's asking an awful lot, but I think she could be certainly capable of having a shot at it. I don't think that would be, she would have those same nerves anymore. She has won one now.
She had a lot of injury problems as well, and that probably helped her make her mind up that she needed a break. She had left wrist tendonitis, and she had bone problems in, I think, the same wrist. But it was just one thing after another. She listened to herself, and also she met Brian Lynch, her husband, American basketball player, and they got married. They've got a child at home now, and you all need to sort of develop outside of this sort of obsessional sort of nature of being a professional sportsman, especially when you're sort of intelligent and you know you need other things in your life.
Yeah,
she falls into that category.
Well, I think that is Annabelle Croft.
There's another one with a big forehand there.
Yes.
2 minutes.
But I think talking about the retiring there in Clisters, that's, they teach you a lot of things on the tennis circuit. They have media scores and they have various other things, but the thing really is not taught is what to do after you finish. And obviously, financially, if you're lucky enough to be ranked, you know, a certain level, the money is not a problem. But, you know, if you stop in your early 30s or late 20s, it's like, okay, what do I do now? And there's only so long that you can lie on the beach or whatever if you don't. There's got to be something that basically fills that void of the competition, and a lot of people find that difficult to adjust to. Pete Sampras, I think, is an example right now who has struggled.
There's a lot more knowledge around now about the pitfalls of maybe being 19, 20, 21 years old, having achieved a lot. And we've had a picture of Annabelle Croft earlier on. Annabelle retired at 21.
Yeah.
I mean, she'd been around about 20 in the world. I mean, you know, surely nowadays somebody would see that there's a potential burnout or a staleness to the situation, and they would change it.
Yeah.
Or they would try to help. Yeah. And there's an understanding, particularly on the female side, where they tend to start younger, there's a real understanding that that's a problem. That's why they have these WTA Tour mentors.
Ladies and gentlemen, Steffi Graf on the top, Sanchez to serve.
Help guide and lend advice through experience. It's a great scheme, that. So what's Pete Sampras going to do now?
Well, he is now starting to play some senior tour events, and I think last year I think he played about 8 events, and I think this year he's perhaps going to play as many as that, if not more. So, okay, it doesn't sound like a lot, but if you put those weeks into perspective, you have to train a month or so, really, at least, to get into that type of shape. So it will give him an incentive to, you know, to keep in shape, and also the competitive urges. I don't think he's going to do anything in media. I don't think he has any interest in that way. And let's face it, he doesn't have to worry about the financial aspect. His wife is an actress, and so I think she's still appearing in some films here and there.
But he
needed something to really get his teeth into, and you know, he's doing so with the senior tournament. So it was a struggle for him. He admitted he did get bored.
So here we go, with a big smile on her face, Steffi Graf, ready to serve to Kim Clijsters. There is an age differential here, and it's 14 years in Kim Clijsters. I mean, you've got to remember, Kim is going to come back and try and be a pro player again here.
15-all.
So this is going to be very interesting for Steffi, who retired 10 years ago. Can she stay with this youngster? It'll be interesting. Hope she enjoys her experience. I mean, how strong and fit does Steffi look? She's
incredible.
Got two children at home,
incredible.
7 and 5. It's been 10 years, yep. And she looks absolutely fabulous, as normal. Sliced backhands missed in this game than she missed in the rest of her career combined.
Oh, that shot was just a knife in backhand, her slice. On this surface particularly. But that was the bread and butter, the forehand. That's where she went for the big shots. The sliced backhand would set her up with that opportunity. And that forehand was just deadly. A bit fed up at that point.
Advantage for Clisters.
I do hope that she came here fit, because this is a very demanding game right now. She's covered a lot of court. Titles in 9 singles finals here on centre court, the roofless centre court for Steffi Graf. She lost to Navratilova in 87 and Davenport in 99. The other 7 she won. No wonder this was such a tough ticket. Really was difficult for people to get hold of a ticket for this centre court celebration today. Straight onto the website as soon as it was announced. 5 minutes later they were all gone. Such is the interest in this day, and it's gone very well.
59.
I say it went very well. The roof closed. That was job number one. Everything smooth.
Just wonder whether there's any chance of Justine Henin ever making a comeback again. There was a few rumours last year, but doesn't seem that interested at the moment. Very happy with her tennis academy that she works at now.
Particularly hard for women, professional sports women, I mean, in tennis, individuals out there in the world by themselves some of the time, or perhaps a coach or whatever, but it's more difficult for them than it is for men. I mean, they can't sort of go out by themselves easily. And Sir Stephen and Mrs. Redgrave.
Oh! 15 love.
She's got that one a little bit late. Pace from Clisters there on the return. It's just impossible that she's sending a text there. Perhaps we should text her, John Wave, see whether she is or not. Dear Virginia, 1977 champion beating Betty Stowe, do you remember? I remember that forehand that she hit. And Betty couldn't handle it on the low forehand volley, I can remember. And then the sort of the leap into the air, it was fantastic. Fantastic. President of the International Tennis Federation on the left, Francesco Ricciabitti. He'll be heading off to the French Open, like so much of the world of tennis. It's just a week away for that.
Time.
Chief of Kent, Vice President of the club, along with the Chairman of the club, Tim Phillips there. So instrumental, Tim, in what has happened here, and just keeping and understanding the need to keep this place at the forefront of sort of sports technology, and this roof is amazing, I must say.
Second service. 30 love.
Good sequence now from Kim Clijsters. Down an early break and she's starting to time the ball a lot better.
Game is closing. Two games all.
So easy for Clijsters here, really, because I know it is an exhibition, but she's playing against a legend, a real legend, and it's quite a few years younger than her as well. If she sort of doesn't win, it.
A little bit cloudy outside, doesn't affect anything too much in here, apart from you can see the floodlights up in the roof looking down, and it just casts just the faintest of shadows of artificial light across the court as the players move across. Never seen that before on centre court, and it just struck me that we were watching an indoor match for the first time. There's floodlights there. It was the air management system they was worried about today as anything else, because they've never had 15,000 people in here. They've done many of the tests, of course, but to have 15,000 breathing organisms in here, I mean, that can affect the humidity a great deal, and I think everything's worked out superbly. There'll be a massive debrief, of course, and they have a month before the championships themselves, but it all seems to have worked very smoothly indeed. As you said earlier, no slipping or sliding, so the humidity seems right.
Seems right. It would be interesting to see when they do the order of play when Wimbledon starts, and if you get a situation where we're always debating after a certain amount of matches were on the court, will they put on a best of five set match at sort of 7:30 when there's the chances of them finishing a slim? Well, now of course there's no problem, so I suppose we could have matches finishing as late as 10, possibly 11 o'clock at night. Wasn't there an out call there?
Or was that Kim who made that noise?
Next step is
30 love.
There's Alison lying in the chair there, but I'll tell you something, Steffi is feeling this pace in a very big way. Look, poor old Steffi. Take your time, though. That's it, take your time. Kim Clijsters plays very fast at the best of times. Be feeling this tomorrow and the next day.
Slip we've seen today as well.
To be honest, on the first day of the championships proper, you see slips in these sorts of areas, just outside the main area.
Many times on the first couple of days.
Just taking a minute there in that game, Steffi. It didn't help her in the end. But most enjoyable. You can imagine Andre and Steffi getting up and hitting cross-court forehand for an hour and a half, can't you? She's very, very consistent.
Love the team.
Love 13. Love 14.
Very well played slice to save the second break point from Graf there. Just, you can just see all the experience throughout the years that she's had out there, and I think she's just hanging in at the moment.
Yep.
She's had to work so hard. Just 26 minutes played, but hard 26 minutes. There it is again.
She does that on every surface.
Yes, she does.
It's amazing how she's never injured herself. She does that on hard courts.
Just incredible. There was two in a row. That one went in, and then this one. Oh, no, not this one. I think it's the one after.